Welcome, everyone, to our season finale of Season 1 of the Medfield College Film Society. My name is Jeff Crawford. I am joined by my society members in another party setting. Here we are. Andy Brown.
Yes, sir.
How you doing?
Man, I'm doing great, Jeff. I'm happy to be here. I'm excited to talk about this movie tonight. You know, it's nice weather outside at the moment, so I'm not letting this pandemic get me down.
Well, that's more power to you. It is beautiful weather outside. Michael Crawford, down in Central Florida, how is the weather?
Yes, sir. Oh, it's swampy as usual.
Have you ridden the swamp ride, or is it closed, too?
Swamp ride is closed right now, unfortunately.
Okay. Well, that's too bad.
As is the place on 192 where you can shoot AK-47s and stuff. So it's kind of slow, but we shall survive.
We will prevail. Robert McSwain, happy graduation. We are done with, we're about done with season one. How does it feel? How you doing?
I'm great. I've been in my house for a month and a half. really having a blast here.
Well, you told me at the beginning of this, you were built for the inside. Is that still the case, or are you cracking?
Oh, I'm an institutionalized man now. I've adapted.
Yeah. You don't need that reform. You got what you need.
Feeding your bird.
Yes.
That's all you need.
Starting my own library.
Oh, that's great. Michael, what are we watching? This is a precious film for you, is it not?
Precious memories of 1991's Disney classic, The Rocketeer, starring Billy Campbell, Jennifer Connelly, Alan Arkin, Paul Sorvino, Terry O'Quinn, and Timothy Dalton as Neville Sinclair. A cast of thousands, directed by Joe Johnston and written by Danny Bilson and Paul DeMeo, tells the story of a down-on-his-luck test pilot who finds himself on the run from the feds, the mob, and Nazis when he discovers an experimental rocket pack in 1930s Los Angeles.
I mean, he had everybody on him. That's like a triple.
Everybody's on his tail. He can't win. Yeah.
Well, so this is a little further on in the Eisner era than the two other previous films we've watched, Journey of Natty Gannon and Flight of the Navigator, which were very early Eisner era hits. This one is kind of in the beginning of what came to be known as the Disney decade. Is that correct?
Yes. And it really ties into a lot of what Disney wanted to do in the theme parks at the time. This was, of course, in the wake of 1989's Batman, which made superhero movies a thing again. And suddenly everyone wanted to make superhero movies, but nobody had the rights to superheroes. You know, DC was tied up at Warner Brothers and Marvel was kind of nowhere. And so people were just snatching up whatever they could, which is why we got like The Shadow and The Phantom, like all these like 1930s radio serial superheroes, because people were just grabbing whatever they could. And The Rocketeer is based on a graphic novel by Dan Stevens, who is just an incredible artist who made this retro pulp hero set in 1930s Los Angeles. And it was what Disney grabbed. Disney grabbed this and they grabbed Dick Tracy and trying to, you know, get in on that Batman craze and sell some toys. And when you look at like the development history of this movie, it was long and very tortured and a lot of really bad studio interference, a lot of bad studio notes. One of the things I saw was Michael Eisner wanted his helmet to be like a NASA test pilot helmet because he thought that was cooler. And, you know, it's always these things.
That's very Michael Eisner.
They wanted it to be set in the modern day. And, you know, it was all about, they just wanted to sell toys. But luckily Dave Stevens was really involved in the production, and kind of they tried really hard to like keep it on track. But
so this graphic novel, that means it was in the time period of, it was like from the 80s or something.
Yeah, it was from the 80s. He was an independent comic artist.
Interesting.
Who drew this, and I mean the art is amazing. He was an absolutely incredible artist, and he kind of actually looked like Cliff Secord. He was just this sort of dashing guy. And it came up during the 80s and was kind of an indie comic darling. And so somehow or the other made its way into the studio system. And, you know, for me, you mentioned the Disney decade. This really ties in my head to the Disney MGM studios in those early days, where this was referenced many times, and we can talk about that. But, you know, there was always hope that, or there were promises that there was going to be an attraction. They really wanted to make this into a franchise. There were going to be, the cast was signed on for sequels. They wanted to make a trilogy, which unfortunately never happened. But one of the ideas for one of the sequels was eventually made into a comic by Stevens, a comic like miniseries. But it ties a lot in my head to the early days at Disney MGM.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's funny that Johnston goes on to direct Captain America, the first Avenger, right?
Yes, he had come up from ILM. He was a designer and special effects guy. He was responsible for the design of Boba Fett and had done already at Disney, had done another classic of this era, Honey, I Shrunk the Kids. And did several other things. He did the third Jurassic Park movie and a few other things, and did Captain America, the first Captain America movie for Marvel much later.
I mean, clearly there is a lot of tie-in between those two movies. It seems like there's a lot of similarities. Oh,
very much. Well, and he had worked on, won an Oscar for his work on Indiana Jones. So there's a definite clear thread through those Nazi fighting movies.
I love this man.
I love this man.
Well, before we go any further into the movie, Andy, have you seen The Rocketeer?
I have seen parts of this film.
Oh, that's right. You hadn't seen it all the way through.
Right. It was one of those that I would always kind of catch, flipping through the channels and see it on and be like, I watch some of it for like 15 minutes and then sometimes I'd have to go do something else. But I am very glad that I've seen it all the way through, because now it was always one of those mystery movies. It's like, I really want to see this thing all the way through because it's got to be amazing, because everything I've seen so far has been amazing. And I got to say, fellas, this one's just okay. I did not love it like I thought I was going to love it. There are parts I absolutely love. Then there are parts I'm like, this is pretty bad. And so, yeah, that's my non-spoiler reaction.
Neither here nor there.
Right.
But we have to get into it to know more. So, Robert, take us in to the world of the Rocketeer.
And we begin in Act One. But first of all, like the Rocketeer font when the movie starts. Huh? I mean, can we?
Yeah.
Who's
who
it.
Likes that?
Thanks.
Oh, that's amazing.
Great font.
Font work throughout.
Really, really good font work there, guys. Oh, nicely done.
They don't make them like that anymore.
I actually had that in my notes. Fonts! Exclamation point.
Fonts.
So the whole movie opens with a hangar door, and I love it because it sets the, we're talking about pilots, we're talking about flying, and we're setting the scene immediately. So they set it up where they're pulling out this giant, huge prop, like plane. Like I used to think this was the coolest plane I'd ever seen before. Like it's not like something you'd ever seen. I mean, at least I had never seen. It's like this oversized, you know, giant single prop, you know, racing plane, I guess, is what it's supposed to be.
Mm-hmm,
and they're preparing for the quote unquote nationals.
The nationals.
I guess that was a thing back then. I'm assuming the nationals would be the national plane racing circuit.
So. Which, I mean, plane racing, the horror. How can you race a plane? It's just terrifying. Yeah,
people did. And this was a real plane. The GP was a real plane, that a very, very dangerous plane. Like they called it like the Flying Coffin and the Widowmaker and things like that, because it was super, super dangerous to fly. But can we right at the very start give a shout out to the score by James Horner?
James Horner strikes again. He did the music for Natty Gann, our previous episode. Yep. And this is a more mature James Horner. I mean, this is one of the better movie themes of this time period, I think.
Yes.
I think it is totally an excellent theme. And they start out with just the theme and bring it in strong.
And that's important in superhero films like this. I think you have to have that theme that really sets them up. I mean, Superman had its theme. 1989 mm-hmm. Batman had its theme.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, so this one definitely played into that.
And it's just, you know, it just fits perfectly with the movie, which, you know, some good themes don't, but this one just feels right on with the material.
Oh, we've introduced to Cliff, the pilot, and Peavy, his friend. I guess his roommate. What would you like? What's their relationship? Do you think
like his mentor?
Yeah, it seems like mentor.
Okay, so yeah, his Obi-Wan, if you will.
And techie kind of his you know, genius tech god.
Yes. So Cliff sticks some gum to the tail rudder, and PV scolds him, you know, for ruining the paint job on a brand new plane. And I kind of questioned why they hadn't tested the plane before they painted it and finalized everything. You think, you know, they at least gotten it out and gotten it off the ground before they got through all those steps. But nevertheless, they had rolled out a brand new spanking plane that PV had built from the ground up, supposedly. And Cliff hops into this little tiny, tiny cockpit. And I remember as a kid thinking that's just looks really cramped.
Terrifying.
I made the same note. I was like, that looks so claustrophobic.
And they put this little tiny, tiny canopy over his head. It's just about the size of his head. Like it's so claustrophobic looking.
Oh my gosh. And
he kisses his finger and touches a picture of Jennifer Connelly, who he has in the cockpit with him. And we are now introduced to our three main protagonists. We have Cliff's girlfriend, played by Jennifer Connelly, Cliff, and Peavy. And now we are told, as the plane takes off and they're going through the opening graphics or credits, we're told that this is Los Angeles in 1938. So pre-war Los Angeles.
Primetime LA.
I mean, already this movie has me excited at this point because I love this era just in history. I mean, just the Art Deco of everything, the artistic style of everything, and the way the movie is starting off. We're talking about planes. It already has like almost like a Spielberg kind of feel to it, where it feels like we're about to do like an Indiana Jones movie. And so at this point, I'm all in. And it's got Jennifer Connelly.
Yes.
It's got Jennifer Connelly. So Cliff gets it off the ground. He comes by and buzzes the ground and shows off a little bit to his compadres there on the ground watching him fly this plane for the first time. And he takes it out into the fields, the orange groves of the area, down in the quote-unquote valley that they're in and out in L.A. And, of course, there come the feds. And they're doing a good old-fashioned 1930s shoot 'em up police chase.
Yeah, I couldn't help thinking about, you know, I'm in the midst of preparing Natty Gann's episode. And there was that scene in Natty Gann where they wouldn't blow up the train because it's precious rolling stock. Well, these cars, they have no problem with completely trashing from this period.
No.
And there's a great line here. They're shooting up the car, and one of the feds goes, you're going to make Hoover mad. And he goes, oh, the heck with Hoover.
Burn.
So,
J. Edgar.
So Cliff and the plane arrive at the airfield. Oh, pardon me. So Cliff flies down and buzzes over this this police chase, and one of the crooks looks up and just sort of half-heartedly shoots at him.
Shot him with a Tommy gun.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, why did he shoot at him? I didn't get that.
Ah, just
like, it's just to be a jerk. I mean, he pulls out his chopper and lets him have it.
Witnesses, man. Witnesses.
And those FBI agents, those G-men, they've got some real accents on them too.
Yeah. They really play up the 1930s pulp, just like the way they talk is all very sort of, this really heightened level of like, I don't know what you would call it.
See us in church.
Yeah, that kind of deal.
So evidently the plane gets damaged. It looks like it threw a rod or something. It starts spewing oil everywhere, and Cliff has to punch out that canopy.
Ugh. I love that shot. That's a great shot.
And I noticed that I was going back and rewatching that shot, and I noticed I paused it. And if you pause it right before he punches it out, you can see where they cut the hole where the plexiglass would just pop out without it, and look like it broke.
Those flying shots are amazing, though.
They are.
But yeah, flying cinematography on the flying shots is great. And it must be like a stunt double plane where they have a pilot up in the front that you can't see. And it's made, that's the only way I could think they were doing it.
Because it looks like totally real. I should shout out the director of photography was Hiro Narita, who's a big time cinematographer, and like all it looks amazing. All the shots are really, really nice. And like you said, looks really, really for real.
So Cliff gets back to the airfield, limps back. The plane's, barely staying in the air. The crooks arrive about the same time and drive into the hangar. The feds have already wrecked their car, but they somehow, drive it through a tree practically.
Yeah. But, I wondered how they came back. I mean, they don't make them like that anymore.
I guess where
just plow into a tree and then make it to the. It was falling apart though.
Yeah, so they limp to the airfield about just a few minutes behind the crooks. The crook gets out, sees the feds coming, grabs a suitcase out of the rear, finds his buddy dead, and we see him swap out whatever's in the suitcase with a vacuum cleaner. A Hoover vacuum cleaner.
Ah, yeah. A really awesome vacuum cleaner. That was
it looks pretty cool. Yeah. So, there's a lot of moving parts in this plot. I mean, for a Disney movie, there are a lot of moving parts in this plot. So we've established the feds are now involved. We got these mobsters that are involved, and we got Cliff and PV, and it's all kind of converging here at this moment at this airfield. For some reason, the crook decides to drive out right when the feds arrive. I would have just stayed in there and shot it out, but maybe he thought he could get away. I don't know. Anyway, he runs out right when Cliff comes down to try to land. He runs into Cliff's landing gear because it has a fixed landing gear and rips one of the landing gear off. I mean, this is a great shot.
It was really cool. That's a really cool shot.
I mean, the only thing I could think of is they had a crane or something that they had the plane suspended on, or some sort of hoist that they were it was coming down, because it rips that landing gear off and then it comes crashing down. And then, it's an amazing practical crash. Plane gets wrecked, and I love Alan Arkin, who plays PV, standing there in this plane, and they're getting Cliff out. The plane's on fire. Cliff gets out. He goes and grabs the picture of Jenny, his girlfriend, and Alan just goes, "Well, that's it. That's into that."
Also, of course, he hits a truck that's has giant letters "gas" on it, which is
blows the truck of gas up. That's true, because that does come back and plays into the plot later. Yes. So, the feds are just complete jerks, and they're also just incompetent too, and we'll explore that throughout the movie. But
cut chin, chiseled chin on one of them.
The classic that guy though. But you know who this guy was, Jeff?
Yeah. He looks really familiar. I didn't know,
because he was super, super familiar. So I looked.
Which guy are we talking about?
Like the taller guy?
Oh yeah, no.
Yeah, the jerk guy.
The jerk guy who gets punched.
The one that they get in a fist fight.
Ed Lauder. He was in that Next Generation episode where Wesley's friends killed that guy at Starfleet Academy. Right. He was that guy's dad.
Okay, and then the baddie that gets caught is like the Ferengi dude.
Yes.
Max Grodenchik, which is so obvious from his odd looking face.
Yes. Which I had never ever realized before this viewing that was him.
Yeah.
So they're pleading with the feds, Cliff and Peavy, about wrecking their plane, and the jerk that we were talking about makes some comment send in a request to, you know, Uncle Sam, maybe you'll get lucky.
He's like, get a real job.
And then like, yeah, then he's like, you know, and he's like, this is our living. And he says, well, then it's time for you to get a real job. I mean, we're at the tail end of the Depression. Like, this is still some tough times going on here. This guy is going to be a complete jerk and tell these poor guys that fly planes and get a real job. And Cliff decks him. And of course, he decks Cliff right back.
Yeah.
He's just been being shot at for, you know, 20 minutes. So, I mean, maybe he's had the adrenaline.
Yeah, he's having a rough day.
Yeah.
Cracking wise.
This whole setup here, I mean, to talk about the Great Depression. So this is 1938. And to dovetail off of the journey of Natty Gann took place 3 years before this. And just think about the different style that we got. I mean, it's just like night and day compared. Like this is like bright and happy, and then Natty Gann is like dingy and dark. And but yeah,
needs more Ray Wise. He should show up,
right?
Just smoldering in the background. I think at this point, I've kind of formed an opinion about Cliff. He's got that classic hero look, but he's a bit of a ditz. If you know, he does not have much brains. It seems like great pilot, but he's just kind of just seems like he's. There's not much there in the head. It's all just, you know, just very manly, just kind of just want to beat stuff up and not much thinking going on.
I think he is very appropriately named. His name is really good for his character.
Yeah, I agree. What if it had been Biff? Would it have been any better?
I think that would have been too far. Biff is unlikable. Yeah, Cliff is like kind of affable dodo guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's very enthusiastic and doesn't really think things through.
Yes.
So to go back to what you were saying about the feds using a lot of like stereotypical. So I love this line here because so they go to question the crook that fled. And he says, your buddy's getting fitted for a pine overcoat.
Yeah. There's a lot. They lay it on so thick with those guys.
I recognize the smaller of the two main FBI guys. You guys may not know this, but there was that actor was in an episode of Wings, the TV show of Wings.
Really?
Yeah. Immediately, I recognize him. He plays like a doctor who Joey and Brian Hackett get to bring in to sign some doctor's note that they're getting sued, and so he's trying to make it out that they got injured and say, yes, they're basically trying to commit insurance fraud. And this guy, and that actor plays this washed up, terrible doctor. So it was just a funny realization.
I was pretty impressed with how the mob guy who hit the gas truck was all right. He wasn't too bad. Well, I guess he kind of bails before he hits the truck. He's
pretty unscathed. Yeah.
Still,
get out of there.
He's beat up, but not like burnt to a crisp.
So that wraps up the airport scene, opening scene, and we've kind of set up a lot of key components here. So they're feds, like I said, feds are involved, crooks are involved, they're hiding something, it's in the hangar now. And we cut to a shot of the Spruce Goose.
Which
means Howard Hughes, played by Terry O'Quinn.
This gains it
John Locke.
An extra star in my book, just for this.
Yeah, I agree.
Bravo.
Absolutely.
Immediately, it was, you know, John Locke from Lost. I was like, this is great.
As Howard Hughes. It's just great. Yeah. It's really good.
It's perfect. It's so perfect.
So I caught a continuity error here, though, because the Spruce Goose was not developed until early into the 40s.
Ruined everything.
After the war had started.
Well, so, I mean, he's working on it. I guess
you could argue that he's already maybe. But as I understood it from the history, was the U.S. government went to him first and said, we need a giant plane for transport during the war. And then he started developing it. But I'll give him, though, that they needed something to really say Howard Hughes. And nothing says Howard Hughes like the Spruce Goose does. Yeah. So. We'll give him a little bit of a pass.
I love his little hangar. Everything's all white and clean. And
yeah,
his office is so good. It's so immaculate.
Yeah. There's a fire roaring in the background.
Yeah. Uh-huh. So he has a huge fire in his
bottle
office.
Bottle of urine.
Bottle of urine. He's got Kleenex boxes on his feet. So anyway, Hughes has cooked up plans for this rocket pack for the government. And he's just been informed that the prototype was stolen, but it was destroyed. And the government agents that are there tell him he needs to build another one. He says, forget it. I'm not building one. I don't work for you guys. I did it as a favor, or I did it just to do it. And the quote unquote X3 is not going to be finished. And you can tell him Howard Hughes said so. And he tosses the plans for the X3 into the fire.
In a 1939 World's Fair dossier, which I was like, don't burn that, dude.
No,
yeah, I caught that too. Yeah,
they made for one of like the anniversary events within the last decade at some point of the anniversary of the film. They made prints of that, like a poster of that, like Hughes Aviation at the World's Fair with the rocket packs. I got to get one of those. So yeah. Good.
Did you guys get the feel? This may be on purpose, but it felt very much like Howard Stark from, you know, Tony Stark's father.
Yeah. Yeah.
Oh, totally. Absolutely. Totally. Yeah.
So we're cut back to the airfield and we're introduced to the late, great John Polito, who I always think of from Coen Brothers movies.
Of course.
And
yes.
He was in Seinfeld. He always sort of played, he had just a bit role in Seinfeld for one episode as the landlord. And in the fur coat episode, but we won't go deep down in those weeds. But he plays the same character a lot in the most movies and shows, sort of this big gruff kind of mean spirited person. And he plays Bigelow here, who owns the airfield, and he's going to charge Cliff and Peavy for the gas they blew up. And they agree to do what is what they call the clown show is all they call it. I think he says the clown show for like 10 bucks.
We don't do the clown show anymore.
That's right.
Did you guys catch what they call him after he walks away? Did you guys catch what they said?
No.
They calls him a lousy nickel nurser.
Yeah.
That's right. Yes. So after agreeing to do the clown show reluctantly, they get into Mabel. Was that what they called the plane? The big biplane they had there?
Yeah.
Miss Mabel. So they get into Miss Mabel, which is this big biplane they have. And Cliff finds something in the seat in the duffel bag, pulls it out, and lo and behold, it's a rocket. And they've discovered the rocket pack that the crooks had hid.
Cliff thinks it's a bomb.
But I also point out that Cliff leaves the picture of Jenny in the cockpit. He climbs in the Mabel and puts the picture of Jenny into the cockpit. So that's just a little... that maybe they'll need that later. We'll know. We'll find out later in the movie here. So it seems kind of strange that he would just drop Jenny's picture off in the cockpit. But he gets the rocket out and immediately, like you said, Andy, just sort of a kind of a dunce here. He looks at the trigger and Peavy immediately says, "Don't push that." And Cliff pushes it anyway.
Yeah. Let's see what this does.
Gotta love Peavy. No, Peavy is great.
Yeah, he is.
Alan Arkin's bringing it, man. Yeah, he's awesome in this movie.
And the pack design and the sound design of the pack, you know, all the sounds it makes, everything, so cool.
Yeah, the rocket pack. I got to ask Michael and Jeff here, was there not like in the MGM backstage tour, didn't they have like some of the prototypes for what they wanted the rocket to look like?
I think they had props from the actual movie.
They had props. So I distinctly remember seeing like three or four different rockets. They had one of the rocket packs, and then they had one that was a single rocket, and they had one because I distinctly remember the single rocket pack.
Yeah,
there might have been just a concept drawing, but I remember seeing it at Disney World. And you guys don't remember any of that?
I vaguely remember. I mostly remember they had on the tour, they had the GB, they had the planes out there.
Yeah,
and they had the dog cafe, which we'll visit later.
Yeah.
But yeah, I vaguely remember that. It's coming back to me now.
As an 11-year-old, 12-year-old kid thinking, well, the double rocket pack is the way to go. That's so much better than the prototypes they had there.
Yeah.
For some reason, I don't remember if it was just a drawing or a picture. I really think they had mock-ups though of what they thought the other rocket, they thought the rocket should look like.
Eisner was like, they should have a little Saturn V on the back. Just tiny.
So the semi-comical misfire happens. The rocket ricochets around the hangar a few times and lands into an office, and they turn it off with a broomstick. And so quick thinking on Cliff's part there. So, yeah, they slowly realize what it is. I mean, to me, it was pretty evident right out of the gate what it was, but I guess, I mean, I don't know.
Hadn't seen anything like that before.
It was the 30s, so they asked, yeah, I guess you're right. I hadn't seen anything like that
before. It was the 30s. They were dumb.
So they figured it out that it's a rocket pack. And then I love the next shot is that they're outside the Charles Lindbergh Lucky Lindy Flying School.
So good. So good.
And they're cutting down the Lindbergh statue.
Like the hijinks of PB and Cliff are really great. They're a great kind of duo together. Like
they really are. Know,
PB the scheming genius and Cliff the kind of dunce muscle guy. He's a good pilot.
Yeah, they are a good. They're like a perfect pairing.
Anyone catch the? They had a boxing bag, a punching bag outside of the Lucky Lindy Flying School.
Nope.
I gotta stay in shape, man.
Yeah, it's right there on the corner. As they were pulling out, I'm like going, "What? That seems like a weird choice by the props department there." But
the Lucky Lindy way.
That's right. Gotta go out there, work on your boxing skills.
Back to Cliff and Lindy. There's a bit of a Marty and Doc kind of relationship there too.
Yes, it feels kind of like that. That is exactly right.
That is a good call.
Definitely. So finally, we're introduced now to the antagonist of the movie. The main antagonists, plural. We have Paul Sorvino playing Eddie Valentine, a great mobster.
Name. So similar to Eddie Valiant in name.
Yes.
Yes. I kept thinking that too. And then we have Mr. James Bond, Timothy Dalton, as a third-rate leading man, as he later calls himself indirectly. And his character's is Neville Sinclair.
Neville Sinclair.
Perfect name. Yeah, great names all around.
Eddie Valentine and Neville Sinclair.
So we find out here that Neville has hired Eddie to grab the rocket. So it was Eddie's guys, Eddie's goons were out there driving around being chased by the feds. So Neville is pushing Eddie around in his house, which I thought, I mean, as a kid, I'm like, okay, whatever. But like I'm watching it now and like thinking Godfather, I thought mobster as a kid, but a real mobster would not let some Hollywood yahoo point a sword at him.
Oh, and, so they're at Eddie's house. I thought they were at Neville's
house. No, they're at Neville's house.
That's it's what at I mean. Neville's
he's at,
house.
He's at Neville's house, but I mean, even still, I mean, what mobster is going to like be like, yeah, okay, you just almost killed me. That's cool.
Yeah, hey, money he also talks, says, man. Send me a check. And it's like, yeah, what monsters use checks?
Eddie's a classy guy. Eddie
must
patient.
Need that money. But the house, oh my
Let's
goodness.
Let's talk about Neville Sinclair's house.
Yes.
Because, this is a Frank Lloyd Wright.
Mm-hmm.
It's the Ennis house in L.A.
Which was used in several films.
Yes. Oh, totally. Very familiar.
Blade Runner?
Mm-hmm. One of two Blade Runner connections in this movie that I can think of.
So Neville tells Eddie that, you know, he's going to, or Eddie tells Neville, pardon me, Eddie tells Neville that he's going to triple his price if he wants to get that rocket. And Neville's being kind of vague about what exactly it is. So even Eddie doesn't know what they're grabbing. And then he finally fesses up and says that it's a rocket. And he says, well, you'll triple my price then. And this is a confusing part here. This may be where Andy starts losing getting off the rails, but we're introduced to a hitman named Lothar. And
oh, this is where I have.
So yeah. We don't see Lothar's face. We just sort of see this big brooding guy, and Neville's talking to him on the phone, and he says, you know, you need to send a condolence call over to the hospital to the Eddie's guy. It's laid up in the hospital right now. And he sort of grunts. And I'm just kind of like wondering why Lothar wasn't the go-to guy from the get-go to get the rocket. Why did he go bring in a bunch of crooks to do it? But anyway.
Lothar's the last resort.
Lothar has a real Dick Tracy vibe on Lothar.
Yes. Oh, yeah. Oh my gosh. Yes. Absolutely. It is totally takes you in a whole different movie.
Yeah. But I was okay with it. I mean, because I'm like, okay, here's the goon. the main goon.
But why is he so
comically?
Yes, like
I mean, they're trying to make him look like there was an actor called Rondo Hatton who had, I guess, acromegaly. Like way back in, he was like a B movie actor who always played like this kind of role. And so they're trying to make him look like that, but it it really takes it's a total Dick Tracy. All I could think of was Dick Tracy. Yeah, and you know, it's surprising because it's Rick Baker who's like a makeup like god, a prosthetic guru or whatever. But it just doesn't fit like within this universe. It's really weird.
Who's the actor? I'm looking for the actor.
His name is Tiny Ron.
Yeah, Tiny Ron Taylor. Yeah. Who played basketball.
He's
not
tiny, though. He's really big.
Yeah, see?
He's
a big guy.
Yeah.
That's a twist. That's
how nicknames happen.
So back at the field now, they have the statue of Charles Lindbergh, and they put the rocket on it. And Peavy has rigged it so they can launch it, I guess, remotely or by wire from a distance. They anchor it down with a chain and stake it to the ground, and it takes off, and it's this sort of like comically just hovers around in circles.
I mean, I need more of this. This is so good. I love this part. It's just great.
So, the stake gets loose and it shoots up in the air. I don't know why, when they saw the stake getting loose, why Peavy didn't just kill the power. But
I made the same note. I was like, why didn't he just turn it off?
Yeah, because he had the switch right there. Like, I mean, click was the stake, and it would have been really easy just to go, oh, kill it.
Oh, guys. You'll never. Because it makes a great gag in a minute. That's why.
All for the gags.
Yeah.
Doing it for the gags.
So it takes off and it's gone, and Cliff makes a comment that he should have tested it himself. And I love this line that Peavy says. He's like, you'd be halfway to Kansas by now, you chowderhead.
You chowderhead.
Oh, Alan Arkin, man. I loved him in this movie. So good. It really made it worth it going back to this movie for that. So after Lindsay shoots out of sight, he miraculously comes back down.
Yeah, they got real lucky because he comes back.
It lands right back, basically right where he took off from. And because it went way up there. We're talking several miles up easily.
Physics people.
Yeah. So Cliff, I mean, to go back to what Andy says, you know, sort of being a knucklehead, Cliff immediately thinks that they should use this to make some money. And so.
He's a desperate man.
So finally now we get to, after that scene, we finally get to officially meet Ginny Blake, Jennifer Connelly.
Ginny Blake.
Oh, my.
So Ginny lives at this boarding house, girls' dorm. I'm not sure what's going on here. I mean,
it's a boarding house.
Boarding house.
So. And Cliff takes her out on a date. And
Mrs. Pye, she gets all over Cliff. She's like, I don't know. Ginny, you don't need to be messing with this boy.
I mean, yeah. This is proof to Andy's point, because Cliff, you got to lock this down, my friend.
Yes. Yeah. I mean, what's going on here?
Seriously.
I didn't look it up when I was watching it this time, but I'm pretty sure that Billy Campbell and Jennifer were dating during this movie.
They did. Yeah, yeah. They did. They were a couple. I mean, they are a very photogenic pair.
Yes. Yes, they are.
Yeah. So I love that Ginny wants to go watch a Neville Sinclair movie called Wings of Honor.
Yeah, which he, Cliff, on his first flight, crashed through a billboard for that movie.
Yes. I missed that. That's great. That. Yeah. So as they get to the theater, there's an interesting plot point that intersects here. And there's a newsreel playing to the theater, and we find out that the Nazi airship, the Luxembourg, is on a peace tour for the U.S., and Cliff scoffs that it's really a peace of the world tour. So I always, as a kid, I was intrigued by this error as well as I'm still am for that matter. But even as a young kid, before he even turned into a teenager, I love the Nazis, and I mean, I didn't love
you love the Nazis.
Wow. You want to rephrase that?
Let's rephrase.
Let's rephrase.
Even as a young man, I just loved the Nazis.
I loved me some Nazis as a young kid. No, I loved learning about this era of history and the Hindenburg, and just so the fact that there was a big airship in this movie really it really made kid Robert happy. That so
you also like Led Zeppelin too, right?
Maybe that's why.
So, yeah, there you go.
So yeah, I love the they're on a Piece of the World tour, but we cut now to Lothar, who's gone to the hospital to go pay his condolences to
Lothar.
He goes and takes this poor guy. He interrogates this poor kid, and then
who names their kid Lothar? Let's just back up for a second.
It is appropriate.
I mean, yeah. I mean, he looks.
I mean,
like
he is a very Lothar-looking guy.
Is that a Bible Lothar. Name? It's kind of like Dorcas or something like that. Right, I mean, where does that name come from?
Dorcas.
So he interrogates his poor kid, gets him to tell him where, you know, where he hid the rocket, and then he basically pretzels the poor guy and kills him. I assume.
Which we figure out that pretzeling is his kind of his signature move.
Yeah,
yeah, it's kind of his James Bond villain move. So
there's got to be easier ways to just kill a dude than
there is like, such
pretzel
a
him.
Yeah, right. There's a really funny thing though where they're looking for him and he's jumped outside and his feet just kind of back off the ledge really
that's right. Just yeah. Scoot away
kind of shimmy. Yeah. Deepy. He's like a very
clearly
like
in
delicate
that dark line of sight. Yeah, he was right.
Yeah.
There.
I mean, he's Lothar, maybe, yeah, I don't know.
Lothar
of the hill people.
That's what I kept thinking. Anyway, so Cliff, we're introduced now to the Bulldog Cafe.
Oh,
so,
yeah.
I love this place.
Now, this is a real place in like vintage LA, and it's recreated in a couple of places in LA now, a couple of like,
really?
Vintage leaning places. Yeah, in smaller scale, but. This is something they had on the backlot tour at Disney MGM back in the day. You could drive by, would have the plane sitting out front.
Yeah, I was trying to remember that. For the longest time as a kid, I thought they shot part of the movie in Florida.
Yeah,
which I think is what they wanted you to think for sure.
So I definitely bought into that until I got wise to it.
I mean, the scene at the Bulldog Cafe and the whole design of the Bulldog Cafe, I could watch a sitcom or TV show situated in the Bulldog Cafe.
Just takes place with all like the character actors all around, and
it's great.
Like I was thinking before when you were talking about Cliff and Peavy, how it's like I'd just watch a sitcom with them, and this would be the like the local hangout would be the perfect setting for it.
Yeah. So we're introduced to Margot Martindale, who plays the owner, cook, waitress, Millie at the Bulldog. I love the TV show The Americans, and she plays a ruthless Russian Nazi spy in that show. So seeing her here was a little funny, but
she's in The Leftovers as well on HBO.
Yes, very prominent in that.
Yeah, good job for her.
Well, she's getting a lot of work, man.
One quick note. I noticed that before the reason they're at the Bulldog Cafe is because that's where Cliff takes Jenny. But
all the time.
She wanted to go somewhere else. And one thing they mentioned, this could be just my lack of knowledge about things, but they mentioned the, what was it? It was the restaurant at the Hollywood, the Brown Derby?
The Brown Derby in LA.
Was that a well-known restaurant in LA or something? I just happened to notice that. My ears perked up because I'd.
Oh, yeah. That. Yeah, that was a big, like, fancy venue. Yeah, totally.
Yeah. So
also recreated at Disney MGM Studios.
Yeah.
Yes.
Right.
And
right.
It's still
that's
there.
That's why I knew
it. Yeah.
Right. You can meet with or have a meal with an Imagineer there. Yeah.
Didn't, Robert, didn't you and I go there on our graduation trip?
We went everywhere.
That's true. But I do think we ate at the Brown Derby.
We did. We
which is really random.
Did you sign the guest book and get your picture on the wall?
Didn't get our picture on the wall.
Man, we missed out.
But soon.
Someday.
We'll get there eventually.
When the park opens again.
When the park opens. Here, Malcolm, who's one of the old retired fly guys that hangs around, rats out Cliff, who hasn't told Jenny that his plane crashed. and Jimmy Malcolm gets
needs
kind of,
to shut his mouth.
Well, he's like carrying on the lineage of Ace Fighter Dodo Birds. I mean, he's just like, what are you thinking, dude?
So yeah, he keeps telling stories about, you know, fighting the Red Baron, and then he starts talking to about the wreck, and Jenny gets mad and she leaves and hops a really kind of cool looking bus and drives off, and Malcolm
That's our
apologizes.
Theme lately, this is really interesting buses from the 1930s.
Right.
We just need to start a whole podcast on 1930 buses.
So I think we already have minutes here. We're 28 minutes in here, and the movie's slowing down for me at this point. I'm like, okay, we started off great, but at this point, I'm starting to get a little tired of some of this long exposition and just kind of not much happening.
The first act is really long. I was taking note of that too, going, man, it's taking a while to get all these plot elements in motion here.
A lot of stuff in this movie.
So there's a lot of stuff going on here.
Yeah, it's a movie that there's like the action and then a lot of slowdown in
between. Just take Lothar right out of that thing.
Yeah. Lothar. So the reason it's important that we point out that Malcolm is upset and apologizes, we'll get to that here in a second, but that's a plot point here that we need to establish. So Cliff comes home, and PV is sitting, he's designing all these parts to the rocket to make the rocket work.
PV's house
really see what he's doing.
Is awesome,
nice
as you would think.
It's a craftsman house. I love that house. Yeah. So
it's like a mini Doc Brown house.
Yeah, again,
Bingo.
And there's a weird thing here. So he comes in, and his date's been a disaster. He's crashed his plane. You know, he's had a rough day, Cliff has, and he's trying to get love advice from PV. And he makes some, you know, snide remark like, "What, you know, why am I getting advice from you? You haven't had a date since 1932. PV sort of like goes off into his own mind for a minute and goes, Flora Maxwell, wasn't no point in dating nobody after her.
That was such a great read. It's so good.
We have to know more. We need to know more.
That was going to be something in the sequel.
Oh, the PV prequel.
The prequel.
Oh, the prequel.
How old was PV, do you guys think?
Probably younger than you think.
Right.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking too. Late 40s, early 50s.
Because he's got white hair.
I'd say late 50s. That'd be my guess.
I think late 50s.
Okay.
I don't know. Maybe earlier than that.
And Cliff's what?
Yeah.
Everybody back in that day looked older than they were.
Yeah, they did. And Cliff's probably what, 26, 28, somewhere near?
Oh, I'd say, yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, I can't say how many times I've written down in my notes, Cliff Lockhart. I mean, lock it down. Like, what are you doing? Going home? Come on, man.
Had one too many crashes.
Please.
Or something. Because,
we're dealing with world class here.
So the next day we find Jenny's, who's on set in a scenery role at a Neville Sinclair movie called The Laughing Bandit. So, can we talk about this for a minute? I mean, this whole... it's just ridiculous. And I guess you kind of get the impression that Neville Sinclair, like, who would you say Neville Sinclair is today in Hollywood?
Oh, well, I was going to say he's an Errol Flynn.
Yes.
Errol Flynn alike for that. I don't know who he would be today. That's a good question.
Hugh Grant. I mean, it's just sort of, the women seem to love him, but all the guys seem to hate him.
An action star too, which Hugh Grant.
He's like a swashbuckling fancy man.
Right.
But like I said, like all the men don't like him. Like they were making jokes about him when they were talking about the movie at the Bulldog.
Yeah.
And Cliff doesn't want to go see his movies, but Jenny is like just enthralled.
I mean, maybe Tom Cruise, kind of.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
I was going to say Ben Affleck.
I mean, I like some of Ben Affleck's stuff.
Oh,
I
don't, here
I
we mean, go. I would,
but Alan Arkin was in Argo. I mean,
but they rag on him because he's like playing this like fancy pilot, you know, pilot guy, and they're all real pilots, so they think he's a big phony. So that even adds more to it. to their disdain for him.
So Cliff shows up at the sound studio and knocks over a flat and almost kills Neville Sinclair right there on set.
Which, again, this is a low point for Cliff in the movie.
Very
this
low. Is super very dumb. Low.
Did anybody get the, when I saw that set, immediately I started thinking of Princess Bride. When
totally. Yeah.
When Indago Montoya, when he's like getting ready, when he's fighting the six-fingered man, that's that scene.
Well, I just kept thinking like maybe a Mel Brooks movie too.
It made me think of Singing in the Rain, kind of those.
Singing in the Rain. I was going to mention Singing in the Rain before because the Laughing Bandit is kind of right. like yes. the movies that they were making.
Exactly.
Like okay. the dueling cavalier, the singing cavalier, mm-hmm. or whatever it was. You know, it's a real similar vibe to that.
So Cliff almost killing Neville gets Ginny fired from the set.
Which is like, why does he rat her out? That's right. When you just leave, dude.
You say, oh, I'm sorry, where's the bathroom?
Yeah.
And just leave, yeah. So.
Again, not much going on between those ears.
No.
What? But let me ask, so here in the scene, like we find out that Charlie, who was Neville's co-star in the movie, gets stabbed. Like, why is that?
That was always a weird note for me. And I've never been able to figure out what that is about, or why that is there. Because it doesn't seem like it's intentional.
Yeah. It feels like something got cut that they maybe that he there was something else going on and they didn't. Yeah, it never made any sense to me, even as a kid, like you said, and even more so now. I'm watching it going, I don't get it. So, big moment here. Neville overhears Cliff. Cliff's decided he needs to come tell Ginny about his rocket because he hasn't been telling Ginny the truth about his life. He's been kind of, you know, keeping to himself, and that's what she was mad about the night before, that he didn't tell her about the plane crash. So he starts blabbing about this rocket he found, and lo and behold, who's overhearing but Neville Sinclair. So now with Neville goes chasing.
A great evil grin, he hears this.
Yes.
Yeah.
And perm. He's got a great perm.
He's got
a perm on. That's right.
An evil perm.
So Neville goes chasing after Cliff, who he hasn't really even seen yet. So he just, but he can't get to him, but he knows that Cliff and Ginny are dating. So instead he goes after Ginny to try to get to Cliff and ask Ginny to go out sometime. And of course she's more than happy because her boyfriend's a dope.
Yeah, and she's clearly kind of starstruck by him too, a little bit at this point.
Definitely.
Yeah. So the next day we're at the air show, it's Saturday, and they're going to be doing the old clown routine.
Clown show.
Classic.
Cliff is nowhere to be seen, so Malcolm decides he's going to do the clown routine to save Cliff's job and help him out. So Malcolm gets into the Miss Mabel, the big biplane, and takes it up.
Now, this is a moment where, to Andy's point, like, I've seen this movie a lot of times, but mostly on TV. And, you know, they talk about the clown show that one time, and then they don't talk about it. And then all of a sudden, this dude shows up, like, in a clown suit, in a plane. And I remember like watching this so many times being like, what happened? Like, I don't understand what's going on. There's not much mention of the clown show before this.
And it's not like he's having to actually perform like a clown out in front of a bunch of people. I could see why Cliff would hate to do that, but he's just putting on clown makeup and flying the plane.
Right.
What's the big deal?
Which I don't actually get.
Yeah,
because I guess
he does some stunts and some acrobatics and just some.
Well, there's other planes flying around.
But yeah, I think the thing is that Malcolm isn't always doing. But before I did miss a point here. So before that, Eddie and his goons have already shown up and they've gotten the picture of Ginny out of the biplane that Cliff left behind.
Cliff,
and then that's when Malcolm goes in and hops in the biplane. So Malcolm's up there flying, didn't know what he's doing. He hadn't flown a plane in 25 years. We find that out. He's dressed up like a clown.
He's just kind of like, oh. Literally.
So weird.
It didn't bother me that much. It really seems to be eating at you guys. But
it just didn't make sense.
It's like, I think you're at an air show. You've got planes going all over the place. Why do you care about a clown? A clown is the least thing you want to see.
Is the clown supposed to like go close to the, I mean, I don't know.
I think it was supposed to happen at like between flights and then Malcolm just messed up.
Malcolm is like, got some real, he got shell shocked or something.
He's got some shell shock.
Malcolm's got real problems.
So Cliff puts on the rocket to go save Malcolm, who's up in the biplane, almost like killing people.
It's like NASCAR, and Malcolm is just like staggering around drunkenly on the track.
Except everybody's in airplanes, which makes it even more horrifying.
It's like NASCAR airplanes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So there's some really good special effects here, though, I thought. There's some really bad ones, too. But I thought the practical stuff of the stunt double clearly falling off of the biplane over and over again.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Really well done.
It's really well done.
All the practical stuff is great. All the, process shots need some love.
Well, it's so weird because I was thinking about, this is a movie that is just right, one of the last, analog special effects movies right before the digital
boom,
revolution, or right before Jurassic Park. And all these the flying shots where the Rocketeer is flying around was a little maquette, a puppet that they shot in go motion, which is how they shot the snow walkers in Empire Strikes Back and all that Star Wars stuff. So it's basically just a stop motion puppet that they had to do all that stuff optically. And this is really one of the last, movies that they really made using those old kind of techniques. And you can tell because it's its ambition are slightly more than what the tech is able to deliver.
I thought there was a nice high, where they hid some of it, where he falls off the biplane and goes into the cloud. And then you see the cloud light up as he fires the rocket. And then
that's cool.
The animated, stop motion dummy comes out of the cloud. I thought that was nice how they hid that. But so Cliff finally, after multiple attempts, he's trying to learn how to fly this thing at the same time. And as he's trying to save Malcolm, and he rams his head through the the bottom of it.
It doesn't help. The plane is falling apart and Malcolm is clueless.
So, and then the plane starts to crash, and he finally gets Malcolm out of the last second, and the plane hits back up. So at the very beginning of the scene, Bigelow is telling one of his guys to move the gas truck way far away this time. And then poor old Miss Mabel, the biplane, crashes straight into the gas truck and blows it up again.
Great bit. Love it.
So I thought, I thought it was a good bit. So...
Well, also Bigelow's telling all the PA people, on the PA, he's hey, there's nothing to be worried about.
It's all part of the show.
Yeah, all part of the show, folks.
So Cliff drops Malcolm off onto a, I guess there was going to be some acrobatic stunts or something they were going to do at the air show. But yeah, it's this big, trapeze catch. So he drops Malcolm off, and he takes off and flies off, and the news crews are all going nuts. And how much media is there for this? This is,
Bigelow's got a lot of hype. Yeah.
Big market.
Slow Saturday in the valley.
All the press is there. They have cameras there. They're really covering this thing. And, so he takes off and goes flying, around the valley, and Peavy jumps into his Model A, Ford pickup and takes off after him. And I'm wondering how in the world is he tracking him? But
he's looking at him in the sky.
Look at the smoke trail, man.
So yeah, following the smoke.
Contrails.
So he crash lands into a lake and skips across a rock. And I remember, maybe you guys remember on the Disney Channel, they did a making of the Rocketeer.
Yes.
And they showed this scene being shot, and they had this whole system where they were dragging a stuntman across and had him skipping across the water, this whole contraption they had built.
And yes, totally. So. This was a shot that got, was like in all the previews and stuff, I remember, as like a wacky gag.
Let's go back to the helmet that Cliff's using. So Peavy makes this. What was we see him making it out of something, but what was he using? I missed that.
He was using an X-Acto knife, which doesn't.
Yeah. He had a hacksaw at one point.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah.
So he was cutting something, and I'm guessing he was kind of cutting some grooves in that he was going to, you know, weld into, but I don't know. It's Peavy, man. He can build anything. He can fix anything.
It's a great look. I mean, this is when we first see the helmet, like with him wearing it, right? And he just looks amazing. That finally completes the whole outfit.
And he looked like a hood ornament, is what Peavy said.
His ridiculous leather jacket that he wears most of the time looks awesome when he's in the Rocketeer outfit.
Oh, yeah.
And the boots.
Like double-breasted button-over leather tunic or whatever.
Very so cool for a superhero. For a dude, maybe not so much.
Yeah.
So Peavy shows up just in time and helps him out of the water, and we get kind of a gag line here where he says he likes it. I like it. They can't get the poor old Model A to fire up. So this was a moment I kind of roll my eyes at, where he pushes the Model A with the rocket down the road at 100 miles an hour. And escapes the Eddie gang, the Valentine gang, and the press. And that wraps up Act One. So to recap, Cliff and Peavy have got a rocket. The mobsters want the rocket. The feds want the rocket. Howard Hughes wants the rocket. Neville Sinclair wants the rocket. Yeah. Lothar wants the rocket.
He really wants it.
Rocket.
Howard Hughes is working for the Defense Department, sort of.
But he doesn't want to be.
I don't work for you, gentlemen.
Cliff's girlfriend is mad at him. He's got his relationship's falling apart.
Cliff's got some
problems. So we have all this stuff going on now. And like I said, that's a lot of plot line for a Disney movie. But as a kid, I love
any movie
at this point. Yeah, for any movie. But especially a Disney movie. So the start of Act Two, Bigelow gets killed by Lothar. And he is pretzeled and folded in half.
Typical pretzel job.
Yeah, pretzel job.
That's your standard pretzel job.
We've seen a lot of this around here lately.
Yeah. A lot of pretzeling going on these days. Oh, well.
Bigelow presumably has given up Peavy and Cliff's address to Lothar, who shows up now. So Lothar breaks in and starts fighting with Cliff and Peavy. Cliff sort of shows up the same time as Lothar gets there, and the two of them sort of had this comical fighting scene.
Because Lothar's just like a wall. He's like all in black, and he's like got Frankenstein build, and he's just kind of moves like Frankenstein.
So yeah, Peavy like throws a some sort of a vase or a candle stick or something at him, and it just sort of bounces off of his face and doesn't even flinch. And Cliff punches him a few times. And then around that time, the FBI has also found the address, and they show up. And this is just, this whole FBI thing starts, this is where it starts getting on my nerves, like watching it now.
Yeah.
Like there's like two dozen FBI agents out front now. And they knock on the door and Lothar opens fire on them and shoots and kills one of them. And then they flee off the front stoop and yell, "Let them have it."
and they unload on this house.
On this house. And the thing that made me irritated was like Lothar's is just standing there, like just shooting with this, with these, I mean, I guess it's supposed to, the guns look really tiny, but I'm assuming that they're bigger because he's a big guy.
It's Lothar.
He has these like comically small looking pistols.
Yeah. He pulls out a pair of pistols and just kind of stands there and like blindly plugs away.
Just for a pop, pops away at him. Yeah. As they're
these guys, I mean, the FBI, they're so just, I mean, shoot first and ask questions later.
Yeah, I mean, they're reckless.
They're just, I mean, you've got the opening with them just shooting up, you know, as they're doing the car chase. And then you've got, then later they just crash into fences. And now they're just shooting up a house without worrying about who's inside or anything else that's going on. You know,
Hoover,
a bunch
man.
Of chowder heads.
Yep. So. Lothar loses his hat. He ducks down and happens to see the plans for the rocket that Peavy's drawn up. He grabs it and decides it's about time for him to split around the same time.
This is another typical Lothar move, is grabbing the piece of paper and like just grab, you know, it's like,
yeah,
anyway, paper. Like
just crumbling it.
Yeah.
There's something hilarious to me in the way his little hat just pings off of his head. It was like they're totally like destroying the house and he's uninjured except just that like ding, the hat goes off the head.
So they all rush around the back door and leave. Like the FBI didn't cover the back door.
Right.
So
multiple exit agents strategies. <It's> I swore if we just got one side and we shot up the whole house, then we'd have it.
I thought we had him. So meanwhile, Jenny and Neville are at the South Seas Club, which is owned by Eddie Valiant. Valentine.
Yes.
Got me.
A real highlight of the movie, I think.
South Seas Club. In my dreams, the South Seas Club exists at the Disney MGM Studios.
Yeah, it'd be so good.
Anybody catch who the singer was?
Oh, yes.
Oh, yeah. Jan Levinston.
Yeah, Jan Levinston is Melora
Arden.
Lore Harden.
Great singer, Jan Levinson.
Yeah. Gould. That's legit.
No longer Gould.
No longer Gould. What happened to Gould?
But this is happening. So this immediately reminds me of Temple of Doom. I'm seeing all
this. Yes.
At the beginning. Yeah. All this. That's why all this just feels right at home with Temple of Doom and all the Indiana Jones. That's why I kind of said earlier, it just feels like a Spielberg-esque type of movie.
Yeah, when you say that makes me, I agree with you there. So there's a lot of like awkward Hollywood elites meeting Neville here. So we have
Clark Gable.
Clark Gable goes by. And then W.C. Fields has a really awkward moment where he ogles Jenny.
Yeah. So weird.
So not just unnecessary. Ogle,
but then the camera pans down.
Yeah, the camera pans down.
Shows the girls, and you're like, whoa.
I know.
Yeah, there's no need to hang a lantern on it. We all know. Yeah, there's no need for that.
Hang a lantern on it.
W.C.
Did anybody catch who the actor was that brought the phone or came to tell Neville that there was a phone call for him?
No. You know, I missed it the first time, then I had to go back. And so say who it was.
It was Clint Howard.
Yes. Oh, wow.
Ron Howard's brother steps out and he tells Neville that there's a phone call for him.
That's random.
Yeah, it was kind of random.
Yeah,
Clint, man, he pops up everywhere.
You know, usually he shows up in the Ron Howard films, but this was an unusual place for him to show up. Again, I just want to point out he's an Andy Griffith Show actor.
He played
Leon.
Yes.
Yeah.
Leon.
So Neville and Eddie are back at their in Eddie's office. So Eddie owns the South Seas Club. And again, Neville has one of Eddie's men killed. Eddie's just kind of like, don't do it again. He killed one of your guys.
He's a very laid-back mobster.
He's a real laid-back mobster.
It's Hollywood, you know. It's not New York or Chicago. That's right.
And then this, the other thing got me was Eddie threatens. He's like, if I get caught by the feds, I'm singing. I'm telling them everything. So he's not only is he a pushover, he's a rat.
Yeah.
I'm going to cooperate with the feds if I get busted.
What do you guys think of Neville Sinclair or Dalton's acting at this point? Do you think it does not seem very good to me. But what did you guys think at this point?
Well, he plays it super over the top.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
On purpose.
Okay, that was my question. Was it over the top?
Feels like a comic book. Over the top. I think.
Yeah. Okay. All right. I'm with you.
Like he's kind of playing that. Because, I mean, the Neville Sinclair is supposed to be like this sort of cheesy guy. So I feel like he's really playing into that, like playing a cheesy actor.
Yeah, I couldn't tell if it was on purpose or actually a sincere kind of a thing. So, yeah, I wasn't sure.
So Eddie's none too pleased that he finds out that Neville's there with Cliff's girlfriend, and he's kind of sort of doing an end around on their job they're trying to pull here. And he decides to send some of his goons over to the Bulldog Cafe now to go shake down Cliff because they've figured out that he's going to be hanging out over there. So Peavy and Cliff are hanging out, hiding out, and they're trying to decide what to do. And finally, Peavy convinces Cliff to call the FBI after they find out that Bigelow's been killed. So as Cliff picks up the phone, Eddie's goons show up and start roughing up the place. And they try to figure out who Cliff is. They don't know what Cliff looks like. They just know that he hangs out around there.
Yeah, they're not very nice.
A lot of great-looking pies. Tragically,
yes. Oh,
meet
man,
their demise.
No kidding.
I'm like, man, don't do that to pie.
Yeah. I mean, of all the crimes against pie, that's the worst. You've got the pretzeling and everything, yeah, but
that's right.
So upon roughing up the place, they're getting ready to fry Peavy's face.
I mean, yeah, that's rough.
Yeah. I mean, they're trying to interrogate some of the guys at the bar there. At the counter, and they put Peavy up against the griddle, trying to get him to talk. And then one of the goons happens to see that Jenny's left her number up on the board there by the phone.
Which, come on, Jenny.
So, yeah.
Don't do that. You got a lot of great that guys sitting around. You got P.F. Sebastian from Blade Runner. You got all sorts of people.
So they give Jenny a call, and to find out that Jenny's out with the Neville at this point. And the goons are now decide they need to go back and talk to Eddie again because they feel like they're getting double-crossed by Neville. So they leave two goons to watch over the Bulldog, and the rest of the goons leave to go back to the South Seas Club at this point. Mr. Ketchup Bottle, Cliff, that they call, because Cliff, I guess, tried to whack one of them with a ketchup bottle earlier in the fight when they're interrogating. They see a picture of Cliff, and then right at that moment, they overtake the two goons. Cliff grabs the rocket, flees the scene, and then they leave us with a little bit of a cliffhanger here that we see a gun sort of pop up over the lip of the attic space that they're hiding, that they climbed back up in to get the rocket, where the rocket was. And they kind of leave us thinking that the goons have gotten them again, but so back at the South Seas Club, there's this great shot of Cliff landing, and it's just sort of a silhouette shadow of him coming down a wall in the alleyway. Yeah,
that's cool. Yeah.
So it's a nice way of, I guess they probably had a dummy or something, because they were able to show that coming down, and then having Billy Campbell walk into the shot. So it was a nice way to kind of cover up some special effects there and give the illusion of him flying without a lot of smoke and mirrors. So he goes in, hides the rocket in the laundry room, which I felt like was kind of a dunce move again to leave your best asset in a pile of laundry unattended. But
I mean, this is one of the problems I have with the movie is, I mean, I love the idea of the Rocketeer, but it's not the most practical kind of superhero because he's constantly having to take his helmet off. He's constantly having to take off the backpack and then do something.
Yeah. It's the same part, you know, the problem with like, as like the Iron Man movies went on, it the tech became more and more magic. So he wouldn't have to like take off the armor and put the armor on. It would just magically appear because it's not very practical if you have to carry, you know, your giant rocket pack around with you, like everywhere you go.
Right.
So even as a kid at this part, though, I had problem because Cliff disguises as a waiter, but he leaves his jacket on underneath it.
And it's like
you see the jacket like underneath the overcoat that, that the waiters wear.
He's not letting that jacket go.
Yeah, he's got to keep the jacket with him, but the rocket
he'll leave the rocket.
But yeah. Keeping it, I don't want to lose my jacket. So anyway, so Cliff sneaks up on the table here and starts serving a bowl of soup. Yeah, he finds Neville and his lady, you know, talking it up at the at Neville's private table, which. It wasn't all that great. I mean, I would have liked a booth if I was an actor like Neville. Oh my gosh. I mean, but
Cliff's doing bits of business here.
Yeah, he's doing some bits here.
Really,
yeah.
Good.
So he's hidden a note in the soup bowl, telling Jenny to go to meet him at the big clam or something. I can't remember now. And he pours the soup into the bowl, and Neville's like, "What are you doing?" And he's like, Fan sent some soup over. And then he just starts
send that man some soup.
I'm a huge fan. Have some soup. That's
right. It's like tomato bisque. It's like,
yeah.
I love that. So Cliff doesn't want to leave. Like, Jenny's like talking about Cliff. And Cliff's standing right there, and he starts like kind of milling around, like playing with the flowers, just not wanting to leave.
Right.
So yeah, Neville gets kind of irritated, and then right when Jenny starts talking about the rocket, he dumps champagne on her to get her to shut up finally, and she excuses herself, and then that's when Neville sees the note in the soup. So now the jig is up. Neville knows that was Cliff. He knows what Cliff looks like. And guess who arrives? But Lothar comes storming into the South Seas Club.
Exactly. That's why you got to have a doorman to keep out your Lothar types.
You got to keep the riffraff out.
You got to have your own giant doorman.
I like soup. I want soup.
Give Lothar the job as a doorman. Just pay him well.
Yes.
Ugh.
Should have thought of that.
So it tells Jenny to leave, but Jenny doesn't leave. She goes out and gets a cab, but no, she just decides to stick around because she starts hearing some commotion going on because Cliff's got the rocket on now, and he's flying all over the room. They're trying to catch him. They drop a net on him because there's a net hanging in the ceiling at the South Seas Club. Sure. So Jenny comes back into the
really
building
good
now.
Point. I didn't even think about
that.
Oh,
it's like a fish net.
The net come from?
Fish net.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's part of the decor. Okay, I'm
with you. But
so. All of your better nightclubs have nets available just in case.
In case a Lothar shows up, you got to have, you know, you got to be able to get him out of there.
Yep, you got wall Lothars.
Yeah, I mean, I guess I got annoyed here because she looks at the window, she sees the commotion. Cliff's already told her there's trouble afoot. You need to get out of here and go to your mom's, but she decides to go back in to the South Seas Club at this
point. Yeah, that was a bad call.
Bad call on Jenny's part. Come on, Jenny.
A lot of bad mistakes.
Cliff is cornered. They have him surrounded. They got guns. Obviously, they don't want to shoot because they don't want to shoot the rocket and damage the rocket. So that's a good part about having your own rocket, Andy.
Right. Keep it on you.
Keep it on you.
Yeah, keep it on you, but he doesn't.
So... he launches and goes up through the skylight, which is kind of a cool shot, I thought.
Yeah.
Yep.
And then Jenny decides, well, jig is up. Better get out of here and go to my mom's house. And this was kind of creepy here. Neville comes up behind her and just happens to have some chloroform on.
Don't leave home without it.
Don't leave home without the chloroform.
This is a classic.
And drugs Ginny and she falls asleep. And that wraps up Act Two. So Ginny wakes up in Neville Sinclair's lair. I'm going to refer to it as a lair from here on out because it's like creepy, like lair.
It's like a Mayan temple of creepiness.
So it's definite lair behavior going on. For sure.
So she's on this white silk bed and she wakes up and she happens to see through the window that Neville has this secret bookcase that he can, you know, hide in and out of. And he's coming. So she fakes like she's still asleep. And he wakes her up with some smelling salts because, hey, again, got to get the feeling old Neville's done this before.
Well, she's like acting like she's asleep and he's wafting smelling salts in front of her. And she's like,
yeah,
impressive.
Yeah.
Then she's like, he makes some comment that you have to be uncomfortable in that evening gown. Slings open a closet full of clothes.
Oh, man.
He's got a closet full of women's clothes.
He might wear them from time to time. I wouldn't be surprised.
Or they could be trophies from his other victims.
Oh, yes, that's also true.
Also, yes.
Yeah, he just confidently looks at her and he's like, both. I know what size she is. Yeah, I'm trying to grab her size.
Either way, he's unusually prepared for such a situation. Yes. Like, creepily prepared for this situation.
And not even, you know, he's just like, yeah, you must be, you know, just really casual about it. It's like,
yeah,
it must be uncomfortable. Yeah. Hey,
so Ginny's kind of, you know, you're kind of wondering now, is Ginny, is she, you know, fallen? Still,
she was got starstruck.
Stars in her eyes, or she? Who knows what's going on here? Because she's kind of like digging it a little bit.
Yeah, she says that terrible line though. She's like, you know, oh, you kidnapped me. I'm so confused. It's like, I gotta say that as much as I enjoyed Jennifer Connelly, I think some of her acting's a little bit subpar in some of this.
Yeah, there's some moments here where I kind of cringe.
I didn't notice.
She put a ring on it.
Cliff,
come on. Forget the airplanes.
If you like it, then you should have put a ring on it.
So as Ginny is trying on her, or trying to get her dress off, she asks Neville for some help, and then she whacks him over the head with a...
Yeah, girl.
And knocks him out cold.
With a vase.
With a vase.
That's what your vase is for. Yeah. It's your basic vase move.
Do vases really knock people out? I've always wondered that.
I guess if it's a big enough one, I mean... Yeah.
I don't know. It seems to be a universal constant in all forms of entertainment.
Banana peels are slippery. Vases knock you out.
She makes a beeline for the secret bookcase here.
Wait, she does a sassy zip up from where she zipped out, by the way.
Oh, yeah. She's
finally
up.
Played a scene with Neville Sinclair.
Aha.
So,
good line.
Burn.
Zip. So she goes into the secret bookcase room, finds
the
radio.
The
book.
Did you see the book? The book was called The Conquest of Casanova.
Oh, too perfect.
Nice.
That's perfect. What, a little piece of trivia there.
Have you read it?
I wrote it, son.
So she finds what you find in any hidden room. You find Nazi literature. You find a radio that's talking to Nazis. You find all kinds of stuff Nazi.
I'm like an enigma machine here. Everything.
Neville's working for the old Hitler man. So,
the Germans.
Yeah, the Germans are coming. So at this point, Neville walks in. He's got an ice pack on his head. Old Lothar's come and helped him out, gotten him up.
Good he realizes that Lothar's a good home health assistant.
Neville declares that he's a spy. He's a saboteur. a fascist, all of the above.
Saboteur.
Saboteur. So Cliff is back at the Bulldog to get Peavy, but we assume the goons have taken him, but have they? Eddie calls the cafe and lets him know that he has Jenny. So why is Eddie still involved at this point? That's kind of what I want to know.
That money must be too good.
So he has Jenny. We'll point this out here. I think there's a little bit of a plot hole here. We'll touch off on this later. So Eddie claims that he has Jenny. He says, you know, here's Jenny. And like I said, can't Lothar handle this now? Can't we just let Lothar deal with Jenny and turn her into a pretzel?
You risk the pretzelization, when you put somebody in the hands of Lothar. You don't want a pretzel, Jenny.
Nobody wants that.
So the FBI barges in at the Bulldog Cafe. This time they come in the front door and the back door.
They're learning.
They seem real proud of themselves. Yeah.
It's a character arc for the FBI in this movie. They
diagrammed that for the whole time in between.
So Peavy has not been taken by the goons. He has been hanging out with Howard Hughes' crew now. So Peavy's over with Howard Hughes, and they're going over stuff, talking planes.
You want to talk sitcom potential. I want the Peavy Howard Hughes show.
Yes. Yes.
Howard. I love the way Alan Arkin says Howard.
He's talking about how he's made built a helmet and make it into a rudder. He's turned the ignition into a throttle and just really made the rocket work better. Peavy's a genius.
Howard's impressed. Point,
ever in doubt.
Cliff comes in with the feds, handcuffed. Hughes is like, what are you doing cuffing this poor man? And then ask him if he knows who he is. And he says, sure, every pilot knows who Howard Hughes is. Howard says, why don't you have a seat, son? I got some Nazi propaganda I want to show you. And this is the kind of Nazi propaganda that Goebbels would have been proud of. So it depicts Nazi stormtroopers flying around in rocket packs, taking over the world, taking over Washington, D.C. It's really...
That's a really cool animation, though.
It's a fun piece of animation. And the animation director on this was Mark Dindal, who did Emperor's New Groove later at Disney. He's done a lot of stuff over the years, but that's one of the big ones. And it's a really cool piece of intentionally retro vintage animation.
Yes. So Hughes mentions that there's a Nazi agent in Hollywood. Cliff immediately realizes it's Neville. So there's a great line that our intrepid G-men have been unable to identify who he is. Cliff says, it's got to be Neville Sinclair. And the FBI is like, no. Can't be Neville Sinclair. Sinclair,
you're screwy.
So they're gonna lock up old Cliff and take him off. But then he jumps away from them, leaps out. So Hughes's office is sort of overlooking his hangar where the Spruce Goose is sitting, the big model. Scale model of the Spruce Goose, and old Cliff jumps on, grabs a hold of the Spruce Goose. It goes sliding down this, contraption. It's sort of suspending the goose, and it takes off and goes sailing out of the hangar. He lets go and safely drops to the ground, and the goose goes sailing off into the dark. And it always made me laugh as a kid. Old Hughes has a few choice words about his Spruce Goose flying and says a couple of expletives. And then on the Disney Channel version, he just says simply, it will fly. But in the PG cut, that's not what he says.
Son of a, you know, it does fly.
It does fly.
So Cliff's got to go save his girlfriend, who's being held at the Griffith Observatory.
Yeah. I mean, if you're going to have a hostage, that's a good place
to
go.
Take him to the top.
There's no better place to go for a view.
And they are doing, James Horner's really ripping off Back to the Future at this this music. Oh,
that's a good call.
Totally like that score.
The heightened tension.
Yes.
So I mentioned a little bit of a plot hole here. So earlier in the movie, we saw Eddie leave with Jenny. And then Neville and Lothar are just talking. And then in this scene, Eddie's there waiting. And then Jenny shows up with Neville and Lothar. So at some point there was a handoff. Maybe they just didn't feel like it was necessary.
Jenny handoff.
So, but it's not a huge plot hole, but I just kind of caught that. So Cliff shows up with the rocket. Everyone's there waiting on him. Cliff decides to point out to old Eddie that he's working for a Nazi. Eddie's none too pleased to be working for a Nazi.
I love this Eddie. Scene. Yeah. I love this scene.
It's very good.
He says his two-bit Nazi, he's not working for no two-bit Nazi, and he's 100% American.
Yeah.
Right.
He's like, I may be a crook, but I'm an American.
It's where all the, plot points coalesce.
So now we get a whole bunch of whoop, 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 whoop moments. So Eddie turns the guns on to Neville Sinclair. Jig is up now.
Gotcha. And they're patriotic mob. I love it.
Suddenly, Sinclair starts laughing. He yells a bunch of German gibberish. And a bunch of Nazi commandos come pouring out of the woods.
Where like, do they come from?
If you've got all those guys, what do you need the mob for?
Exactly. So, he had a bunch of Nazi commandos at his beck and call. Well, I took it that they were traveling with the Luxembourg Zeppelin.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So
I just maybe they've just been hiding in those bushes for like a week.
That's what I was thinking. I was like, what were they doing there? Just waiting for them to be called for.
So the commandos surround Eddie now, and now Eddie has to put down his weapons.
I love a good like reverse surround. Like Eddie turns his guns on the Nazis, then the Nazis show up and turn their guns on Eddie, and then the Fed turns up and turn their everybody's like aiming at everybody.
So the Luxembourg shows up, and that's when the FBI shows up around that same time. So the big huge Zeppelin, which reminds me of the big Zeppelin from The Last Crusade, Indiana Jones.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yep.
So same kind of effect. I'm assuming that Industrial Light and Magic did this or had something to do with this.
They did. They did indeed.
So that would explain it. It may have been the same mock-up they used in Last Crusade then. So, the FBI has now shown up, and whoop, 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 the tables have turned once again. FBI opens fire on the Germans, and
of course they did. It's coming and shooting.
I love, there's a great line, though, as the FBI shows up, one of the goons goes, it's the feds!
Yeah, you got to get that in there.
Yeah.
So, Cliff escapes, shoots the rocket, and he goes sliding across the ground and knocks out a Nazi commando in the process, goes sailing off into the bushes. Eddie grabs a Tommy gun and yells, lousy krauts, let him have it!
Which I love Paul Sorvino so much.
So the feds and the mobs are mowing down Nazis at this point.
There's a great moment where, like, Eddie and winds up next to the FBI guy and they give each other kind of daps like, hey man, what's up? Hate Nazis, yeah. Right? Yeah.
We can all agree that we hate Nazis.
And they're both like just totally unloading with their Tommy guns and are like, I mean, yeah, what's up?
It's so American. It's like, let's just shoot some Germans.
There's also a great warning here. One of the feds yells that there's a Zeppelin's full of hydrogen and they better not get a loose bullet up there. So,
why? What would happen?
Well, I guess we'll find out. I don't know.
Check off a Zeppelin.
Neville escapes with Ginny into the Zeppelin, and we have a great hero moment as Cliff runs after them and gets to the top of the observatory with the American flag blowing, and they all yell, look, it's the Rocketeer! And he launches off towards the Zeppelin and his rocket.
And yeah, great shot.
Eddie tells him to go get him, kid.
It's a Rocketeer. He's wearing the exact same thing that Cliff wears all the time and won't take off.
So Cliff arrives on the top of the Zeppelin there. And here comes Lothar. Ugh. Lothar comes hopping out, puts on a strap so he won't fall off.
And I thought it was nice. Lothar was like safe.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's Lothar, proper
OSHA safety technique here. Yeah, he's
yeah.
Lothar has the size appropriate wrench, you know, just the wrench that only Lothar can carry.
Yeah, what are you using that wrench for?
That's a pretty big wrench. Yeah. Cliff immediately knocks. Well, Cliff loses his gun that he has gotten, his Luger that he'd gotten off of one of the commandos. So now he's doesn't have a weapon anymore. But he still got the rocket. Hadn't taken that off. Flies around, knocks Lothar off the Zeppelin. Lothar goes sailing over the side. Smashes into the bridge.
Which that's kills unnerving.
One of the pilots.
Yeah. It's like dark, and then Lothar swings in upside down.
Yeah, that's a weird shot where he's just kind of like silently swinging in the night.
Yeah.
So Cliff shows up on the bridge, comes down off the top, hands Neville the rocket, pulls the gum loose, which we forgot to talk about. So earlier in the movie, when the goons were shooting up the bar, had a loose shot, hit the rocket, shot a hole in the back of it. Good old Peavy happened to see it, patched it up a little bit of gum.
Stick some Beamans on there.
Yep, yeah, got some Beamans on there. So it's a good thing that that old Cliff always has gum in his mouth. So he moves the gum loose. So now the rocket's
leaking. Wait. We got to go back to, now that we're going back to that scene to mention, it's always so jarring when Peavy takes the gum out of Cliff's mouth. He like gets his fingers way in there.
Oh,
like
yeah.
Like wrenches that gum out of Cliff's mouth. I hope Alan Arkin really washed his hands, because he really goes for that. He goes for that gum hard, yanks it out of Cliff's mouth.
So this may be a point where Andy loses it, because I was getting a little annoyed at this point as an adult watching this movie. I loved it as a kid, by the way. But why not just let old Neville have the rocket now? Let him leave. I mean, he's got it. Nothing's leaking. It's going to blow up. Yeah. I mean, everyone knows it. Nope. We got to get into a fist fight. So
you actor, bam. That was a great so line.
Makes some joke to Neville about, or some jab at Neville for being a Hollywood softie. And Neville says he does his own stunts. He decks Cliff a couple more times. And Jenny decides, as they're fighting, to pick up a flare gun now, because that's smart. Shoots a flare gun in the cabin.
Yeah.
Bing, bong, bing, bong, bong.
Didn't they hit the captain or something and knock him out the window?
She totally kills
that captain.
So, yes.
Jenny's got blood on her hands now.
Who's pretzeled now?
You got flared.
So, anyway, now the cabin's on fire. Now they're trying to tell Neville, hey, help us out, put this fire out. He's like, yeah, screw you guys, I'm getting out of here. And he takes off with the rocket, flies out, I don't know, maybe 50 yards. He blows up into a fiery ball of...
Bad special effects.
He lands on the Hollywood land part of the Hollywood sign and blows up the land part.
Nice little gag there.
Nice.
Cliff announces that when the fire in the bridge reaches the envelope, which I guess is the part that holds the hydrogen, I would assume, that they're all going to be dead. So they get to the roof, and they're saying their goodbyes to each other, and they're going to see each other on the other side, et cetera, et cetera. Lothar's back. Lothar's climbed back up again.
They can't get rid of Lothar
that easy.
Lothar bounces back.
So he starts trying. He's got a switchblade now. I don't know why he didn't pull the switchblade earlier.
Yeah, where was that before?
A giant wrench.
He had the giant wrench before, but he lost that.
Wish he'd had a giant switchblade.
So it's like a 17-inch switchblade.
Yeah, like a lightsaber switchblade.
So around that time, the Zeppelin starts to explode in phases. So I guess...
I dig that. Like the way it blew, like chamber after chamber is blowing up. It looks really cool.
Lothar's still tied in. He starts running. He can't go any further. He gets consumed.
See, safety, being overly cautious, bounces back and gets him.
Finally.
And then out of nowhere, here comes Howard Hughes and Peavy, and they're flying in an autogyro. Pardon me.
Any movie with an autogyro gets an extra star just because.
And we've seen it a couple of times. It's been sitting over in the hangar at Hughes's personal hangar off in the corner. So they got that thing out. Drop a ladder down. They grab Jenny and Cliff right as the Zeppelin blows up. Lothar's dead. Sinclair's dead. Assume the Nazis are all dead. The feds and Eddie have made up. They're friends now because they've been killing Nazis together.
I just love that any movie that like culminates at its like apex with Howard Hughes swooping in to save the day. That's good. That's good movie making right there. That should be in film school.
I agree. I made the exact same note. Howard Hughes saves the day.
So back at the Bulldog Cafe, Peavy is joking about how Neville Sinclair died when debris from a Zeppelin explosion landed on his touring car. It's a fancy car. So that's a shame.
That's a way to go.
Outside, we hear a plane arrive. We walk out, and Howard Hughes has shown up, and he's got this fancy new white racing plane.
Beauty.
Yeah, it's nice.
Hughes hops out, tells Cliff it's his, asks him what it's like to fly with a rocket strapped to your back. He says it's like it's the closest he'll come to heaven. Or maybe not, as he glances over at Jenny. And as Jeff has pointed out over and over again, what are you waiting on?
Yeah, really? On, seriously, son.
And then we also notice that the Jenny pulls out the plans that she found at Neville Sinclair's house and hands them to Peavy, plans for the rocket. So
they are surprisingly smooth after Lothar, crunched them.
Wadded them up. But nice job, Jenny, on the save.
Yeah. For a possible sequel, maybe? Who knows? But that wraps up The Rocketeer.
Is there a reason that the sequel didn't get made?
Well, it all comes down to money. The movie made back its budget, but it just wasn't. It's one of those Hollywood things where everything has to be like an enormous success and sell a ton of toys to like be a thing. And, Eisner wanted big Batman dollars, which was never going to happen, but whatever. But they did have a sequel planned, and there's a graphic novel about it. It takes place in New York. In like 1930s, 1940s New York. So that would have been really cool to see.
Yeah, I would have enjoyed that.
More fighting Nazis, man.
Yeah, that'd been great.
But yeah, they were all signed on, and they were like plans ready to go, but it just never happened.
We had a friend, I'll tell this story. I liked this movie as a kid. I mentioned it earlier. This is really one of my favorite movies as a preteen. And we had this kid in middle school that was friends with Jeff and I. And he was kind of a curmudgeon when it came to liking things. He always seemed to hate everything. And I remember he was so excited that he got this on VHS for Christmas.
Oh, wow.
And I was shocked that he liked it so much. But I was like, oh, okay, well.
But yeah, there's so much potential here. And, they did a couple of things in the parks. One of the really cool things they did for a brief time after the movie came out, they had a fireworks. It was when they used to have fireworks at the studios, and they actually had like a special Rocketeer version of the fireworks where like the Rocketeer would come out and fly like before the fireworks. And I never actually got to see that in person. I've seen like video of it, and it was really cool. I mean, really cool to see. And like we mentioned, a lot of stuff on the backlot tour, and I don't know if it's still there. I guess it is. One of the places on Hollywood Boulevard there that sells Coke is called Peavy's Polar Pipeline.
Yeah.
Yes, I have seen that. Yeah.
Named after Peavy, and that even has, I think it has like a hidden rocket pack like tucked away in there.
That was there fairly recently. Yeah.
Yeah. Which is, it's a weird, it sells like Coke slushes and stuff, which makes no sense, but it is at least a reference to Peavy.
this movie has a few echoes of The Absent Minded Professor in it, in a way, because you've got this, you know, this woman who has a lot going on, still putting up with this, you know, guy that doesn't really have much going for him.
Do not think the two women are in any way compatible or comparable.
No.
Yeah, Jennifer's definitely better. It's like better. I said,
echoes of it. But
yes,
echoes. I would also love to have seen an Alfonso Hawk kind of appearance in this kind of film. That'd been amazing.
Seems like a natural fit.
Yeah.
Maybe Neville Sinclair could have been a little gruffer.
Yeah.
Or
my boy, there's a rocket pack. Oh, yeah.
Replace Eddie Valentine with Alonzo Hawk, and you've got that's good times.
And then replace him with Eddie Valiant.
Yeah.
All right. Well, it is time for us to rate this thing using our.
I'm excited.
Yeah. Oh, me too. We're using a unique scale tonight, Robert. What is our scale?
We are going to be scaling this on sticks of Beeman's gum.
Yes. Yeah, did we classic. Mention that Hughes gives Cliff some Beemans at the end of the movie?
We did not mention that. But yeah,
also a favorite of Chuck Yeager's. Also also plays a big part in The Right Stuff.
The Right Beemans. Stuff. Beemans.
Who knew?
So, on a scale of 1 to 5 Beemans, we will say, plot and writing, Michael Crawford.
Well, you know, I understand a lot of Andy's criticisms of the film, and the plot is kind of stop and go, kind of convoluted, but you know, I'll give it a 4 Beemans, because it just contains too many. I think the high points are really high, and it just contains too many sort of elements that I love in a movie, so that. Cuts a lot of ice with me.
Yeah, I'll go next because I agree with that. I'll give it a 4. I feel like there is something missing from the plot, but it is too many things that are too enjoyable. And I think also the dialogue is pretty well done. So other movies suffer from that. Robert?
I'm going to go. I think if you'd asked me this, like, 15, 20 years ago, I would have said 4, but I'm going to come down to a 3. A lot for what Andy said. I think that it's through the stop and go of the plot. I still love the movie, but it just wasn't quite a 4.
Andy?
I agree. Yep, that 3 sits perfect with me. All the same reasons.
Perfect 3 with you.
All right.
Okay, casting. I'll go first. I will say a 4. It's not out of the park, but there were some good choices. A photogenic couple in the middle. I thought Alan Arkin was excellent casting and acting, which we will get to. Terry O'Quinn, come on. But the fact that there's just a lot of people who would go on to have a lot of roles later is a sign of pretty good casting, in my opinion. Andy, what did you think?
Yeah, casting and acting, it's tough to separate those two sometimes. But, I mean, every person had the right look. And I thought there was times, again, this kind of bowls over into, or kind of rolls over into the acting kind of stuff. So I want to give it a 4, but also I'm torn between a 4 and a 3. So I'm gonna go with the lower number and stick with a 3.
Okay, and Robert?
I'm going to go with a 4. I think the casting was pretty good. And like you said, you had to separate the acting from the casting. And I thought it was all there as far as the cast was concerned. So I'm going to give it a 4.
Michael?
Well, I too agree. It's hard to separate. These are categories that are hard to separate from each other. I'm going to give it a 5 just because I love like the whole lineup of character actors and stuff. And you know, you have the two leads who are like perfectly suited for this like sort of old school matinee kind of a deal. So I think as far as just casting a lineup of people, it's pretty good.
Okay. Acting, the related category, Andy, what you got?
Aside from Arkin, I'm going to have to give it a 2.
Ooh.
Yeah, I did not. I thought the acting was subpar. I mean, I liked Howard Hughes. What was that actor's name?
Terry O'Quinn.
I thought he was, O'Quinn, I thought was really good. I thought Alan Arkin was really good. I still could never really tell if Timothy Dalton was doing things on purpose or not. And so, I mean, he's never been a favorite actor of mine anyways. He was one of my least favorite Bonds. So, yeah, I'm going to go with the two.
And I'll go with a three here for kind of similar reasons. I thought the leads weren't the best acting, Arkin aside. So, Robert?
Saying everything that Andy said, I agree, but I think Arkin pushes it up to a three for me and O'Quinn.
And Michael?
I'm going to be on the higher end with a four, just because I think a lot of the supporting characters are really good. I do agree that the leads are the weaker part, especially. It's unfortunate because I really like Jennifer Connelly and I like Jenny, but they make her kind of a wet blanket for kind of too much, which I guess isn't really the fault of the acting, but you know, she's just kind of there for a lot of it, which is unfortunate. I cut him a break on like the sort of the cheesiness because I think of like Neville Sinclair, because I really think that's intentional and they're playing into like a 30s serial kind of adventure vibe. So I think a lot of it was intentional. So I'll cut him slack on that.
And production value, I'll start with that. And I want to give this a five because the practical stuff is great and the music is exceptional. All the cinematography is great, but I'm going to put it at a four because I thought some of the aforementioned process special effects kind of took me out of it at times. And it felt like maybe it was, like you said, Michael, a little too ambitious for its time. Maybe they should have just done a little bit less. It would have been, I thought everything that they did practically was top notch, great. The design was great. Everything was great, but I gotta knock it on those special effects. Robert?
Everything you said. I thought cinematography was great. The practical effects were amazing. I love the plane sequences. I love the plane crash. I thought it was a really good plane crash. The music is phenomenal. Horner, he was firing at all cylinders. But the stop motion Rocketeer flying stuff is what brought it back down to a four for me.
And Michael?
Yeah, this is a hard one. I'd go 4.5 if I could. I'll say 4 too. I mean, just the costumes and the sets, everything looked so good.
Yeah.
And it was shot so well. But like some of the practicals, I mean, some of the analog effects and Lothar being kind of a sore note, I'll knock it down to 4.
They should get Lucas to do a special edition of this.
With CG dancing Lothar,
like
Lothar rocks,
like 100 times as many Nazi commandos,
all holding radios.
It comes to say holding radios instead of guns. That's right.
I'm gonna agree with you guys. It feels like it should be a 5, and it almost feels a shame to knock it down to a 4. But I've got to go with a 4 on this.
I just feel like that stuff is too distracting. Yeah.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Overall entertainment value, we'll start with Robert.
This is a great movie for me as a kid. I went a long time without watching it, maybe 20 years, and I picked it back up a couple of years ago, and I was less entertained as an adult, but still entertained. I'm going to go with a 4.
Okay, Andy?
Like I said, there was parts of this I really loved. There was parts of it I did not like at all. So because of that, I'm just going to get right in the middle of the road, and I'm going to go with a 3.
I will say a 4 for me as well. I love all the elements, and something in it doesn't come together to make it that excellent thing. So, but you know, the nostalgia of it, and the design, the music, all of that is excellent. Michael?
I'm going to echo pretty much exactly what you said and say a four. It's unfortunately, it doesn't wind up being more than the sum of its parts, but like a lot of the parts are really amazing. In the end, the connective tissue isn't quite there to make like a single piece of excellence, but there are parts that I like more than others. There aren't any parts that I don't like Andy, but I mean, the stuff that does work, I think, is just so cool. And it hits so many buttons for me of, you know, stuff I think is neat. So yeah, I'll go with a four.
All right. So let's punch that into our computer that wore tennis shoes. Robert, what is our grand score for this movie?
I'm excited to say that our computer that wore tennis shoes has been upgraded. Oh. And we're able to track a lot better now. It came in at 3.65, which puts us fourth overall out of 8 movies.
Okay.
Right behind Natty Gann at 3.9. And Absent-Minded Professor and Flight of the Navigator sit at the top.
Okay. That makes sense, I guess. Where's Three Caballeros, I always like to ask.
Three Caballeros is coming in at number 6 with a 2.33.
Oh, yes.
Oh, man.
The controversy.
It's just Andy dragging us down.
Right, man. Above Boatnicks.
Well, we can all agree on Boatnicks. That's up.
I'm surprised Freaky Friday wasn't number 1.
The outrage. So we have rated it. Michael, what did Leonard Maltin have to say about The Rocketeer?
Leonard Maltin says, film captures the look of the 30s as well as the gee whiz innocence of Saturday matinee serials, but it's talky and it takes too much time to get where it's going.
Well said.
Leonard.
See, Leonard.
He also says, film buffs will get a kick out of the Rondo Hatton-esque bad guy being Lothar.
Nope.
So negative. Leonard enjoyed Lothar for some reason.
Well, that was our season finale, and I'm going to take the next section here and just talk for a second. I want to thank all of you for joining me in this venture. We have done 8 movies. We've done 7 with our entire crew. I want to thank Michael for joining us. It's been great having you here. Yeah, your knowledge is second to none. And Jeff's ability to drive the ship and then edit the ship in post-production has been great. And Andy, well... your hatred be said for some of the movies has been really funny.
And your knowledge and your of the Andy Griffith show.
And your knowledge of the Freaky Friday stuff. To this, your love for Freaky Friday is an all-time high for me on this. I think it's one of my favorite moments so far.
Which kind
of leads me into my next quick little section I wanted to do is kind of have a quick discussion about our favorite moments of the 8 movies that we've done.
Oh, that's a good question.
I mean, I'm living in the throes of Natty Gann, but I cannot get over how much you took objection to the wolf and Natty Gann, Robert.
I guess when I was watching it, I was just really fixated on the wolf and his acting. And it just felt like he was phoning it in some of those scenes.
Jed, man. So. Jed was bringing it. Come on. He got her that rabbit. That was nice. I don't know. Just going back to the start, listening to you guys talk about Gus was something else. And then watching Gus, which I hadn't seen in I don't know how long. And I was trying to describe Gus the other day to somebody and words failed me. So seeing some of these things that I hadn't seen, I don't even know when I saw Freaky Friday last or if I'd ever seen it all the way through. So yeah, seeing some of these things with fresh eyes has been very interesting.
Yeah, I mean, I think seeing, I don't remember seeing Freaky Friday either. Watching some of this stuff and watching it together with the idea of like putting it into a context is pretty interesting. It's kind of a fresh lens of, especially these last 3 we've done that are kind of very similar time periods. It kind of tells a narrative of what the company's trying to do in an interesting way.
Yeah, for real.
I've enjoyed revisiting some of these movies that I remember hearing about and seeing parts of, you know, when I was a kid, especially going back to Fly the Navigator. I mean, loved that movie. And then being also being introduced to a lot of this new stuff, because, you know, I'm the person who's not seen most of these. And so that's been, it's been entertaining and sometimes entertaining, sometimes not so entertaining to,
I think when you're not entertained is when I'm fully entertained.
yeah. So that I've enjoyed that aspect of it.
Well, even outside of the show, seeing people's reactions to, like, especially I think Flight of the Navigator, the way people reacted to that when, like, we first started tweeting about we were going to do that show and people being so, like, psyched for it because people love Flight of the Navigator. And so it's been kind of fun to see, like, other people who had the same experiences or were kind of obsessed with the same stuff, the same little details from the movie has been kind of fun to see.
Yeah, I've enjoyed connecting with the fans as well and finding people that share our joy. Because, I mean, I'm picking these movies. I mean, basically, these are movies that I've loved growing up, with the exception of a few. Like, I mean, even Boatniks was one I enjoyed growing up. But, I mean, I'm sort of just going through my memory of things that I like to watch and sharing it with you guys and hearing your thoughts has been really great. And then finding out that people out there think like I do. So I'm enjoying that as well. And as I mentioned, the computer that wore tennis shoes has been hard at work, crunching numbers, and we've broken it out now into everyone's top movies. And so the overall top movie, as it sits right now, is The Flight of the Navigator with a 4.3. Right behind it is Absent-Minded Professor with a 4.15. My top movie was Absent-Minded Professor and Flight of the Navigator tied at 4.2.
Ah.
Jeff also tied Absent-Minded Professor and Flight of the Navigator at 4.2.
Whoa. Same.
Andy's top movie was Flight of the Navigator by a long shot at 4.2.
Over Freaky Friday?
Over Freaky Friday.
Oh, yeah. Absolutely.
Wow.
Absent-Minded Professor came in second, was tied with second with The Journey of Natty Gann at 3.6 for Andy. And then Freaky Friday was at 3.4. Andy's most hated movie. Andy's scale is the one that's I find the most intriguing when I started putting these numbers together. He hated Gus. It was 1.2.
So did I. Yeah.
Right above it, just a 0.3 of a point ahead, was The Three Caballeros.
Yep.
Man,
that's at a 1.5.
I love those Caballeros, man.
That movie makes no sense.
Well, agreed. That's the point.
Agreed.
And then Boatniks was just ahead at 6 for Andy. Man. And Rocketeer was 5th. Freaky Friday was 4th for Andy.
I apologize for nothing.
And then Michael, his scores are really high. So Absent-Minded Professor and Flight of the Navigator again are tied at 4.6.
Wow.
The Journey of Natty Gann coming in at 4.4. Rocketeer coming in at 4.2.
Oh, you like, wow.
I'm throwing off the curve. I'm surprising myself.
Yeah.
And then Donald and Company coming in at 3.2 with a 5th.
Man, that is bizarre.
And then Freaky Friday coming in at 3.
There's no way you like Natty Gann more than Three Caballeros.
Yeah. We may have to go back, and because some of our early things were on like a 4-point scale.
Yeah, that's
so true. I don't know if this is like weighted. Well,
I went back through and re-listened to the scales that we gave and double-checked them against this earlier in the week. But yeah, I think we did want to I guess that's my next question is, listening to your top two or three or four, are there any that you would change now after watching all 8 of these movies, or 7 in Michael's case?
I mean, I think I would agree with my top two. You know, if I was going to put a movie on, I might put on Three Caballeros.
Yeah.
But as a complete movie, I wouldn't rank it as high as the other two.
Jeff, you and I are mirror all the way down until Freaky Friday.
Same. Wait.
Freaky Friday is ahead of Three Caballeros for me.
Well, you know, I had to weigh down the averages like Andy usually does, because Andy was flying so high. I was like, I go to the bottom. Freaky Friday angered me at times.
I think you gave Freaky Friday the lowest score of anybody.
Yeah.
You gave it a 2.
Yeah.
And
I wanted to torpedo
it. Too freaky.
It's too freaky.
Yeah, I'm staying by. I think I'm very pleased that in my consistency as far as my movie ranking. So yeah, I'm happy with that.
Oh man, too good. Well, what did you all think? We'd like to hear from you. Please let us hear, as we always beseech you. Twitter, Instagram, Facebook, we are at Midfield Film. And then you can email us at info@midfieldfilm.com. And yeah, please write us for suggestions for season two, anything, any kind of suggestions whatsoever we are open to. We will be, doing some new things coming up. We might be doing some things before season two. We're just gonna let you all, who knows, the sky's the limit, really.
It's true. Just strap on that rocket back and go.
That's right.
But let us hear, yes, do let us hear what you would like to see, what you would like to see in the future.
It's all open. We could do the other versions of Freaky Friday. That could be season two. We could do the other versions of Absent-Minded Professor. We just do the same thing.
Yeah. That's true. We just do all the remakes.
We could do Saludos Amigos everything. Instead of Three Caballeros.
Yeah.
It's kind of easy.
But we do have a few little sneak previews for what's coming up in season two that I kind of want to get to. But we will be going back to Medfield College in our season premiere. But
yeah.
But in what movie?
Got to check in at Medfield.
So we'll be checking in at Medfield right out of the gate. And we may be taking a trip to Lucifer Falls for a Halloween special.
Wow.
Ooh, you've intrigued me.
I wish I knew what that was.
Me too.
And we're going to close it out with a real, with a bona fide Disney tearjerker. We're going to find out just how stoic our society is. Ooh. So stay tuned for that. And we got a lot of big surprises coming up there in the off season, as Jeff mentioned.
Yeah.
Maybe some interviews.
Could be.
Maybe.
Could be.
Maybe not.
A lot of spoilers. A lot of teasers here.
A lot of
here.
Spoilers.
Yeah. So stay tuned. Follow us on social media. Keep your podcast feed on. Don't take it off. We will continue. We'd like to thank our sponsor, Mr. Todd Naparick of Bindin' Graphic Solutions, for all our graphic design work. Hey, the summer's coming. You know what that means. Family t-shirt designs for that big family summer vacation, if you take it. I don't know. Maybe not. Did you know that Todd would do that sort of thing? Yeah, he will. That and so much more. Maybe it's a staycation. Maybe you want a t-shirt for that. I don't know. Go find him on Facebook, Upwork, ask him. Todd is a graphic designing machine. And I mean that. He's up all hours of the night designing graphics for us all night. That man will get the job done. He'll do whatever you need as far as graphic design is concerned. Todd's going to make you look good, real good. BindandGraphics.com. BYDAND graphics, not with an X, .com. Check him out.
He's like the Lothar of graphics design.
He is.
He'll pretzel that for you.
He's got the giant graphics. Wrench. Yeah.
I do graphic.
We will see you soon, and we will see you in the fall for season two. Stay tuned in the meantime. We'll be at you sooner than that. Everybody stay safe out there. We've enjoyed being in your ears. All right, everybody. From all of us at the Society to all of you, thank you. Be in touch. We'll see you soon.
Proud are we of mighty Redfield, our mother dear. All your sons and daughters hail to thee, Redfield College of Technology. And while we hold your banner high, rah, rah, we shout your praises to the sky, rah, rah. For proud are we of mighty Redfield, loyally we cheer. Redfield.